This will be a teardown and a little test and some modifications from this thing here I bought from Banggood and delivered some time ago. I made already some changes to it because this is I doing this bit after that I made the video, and it is DY294 from DOE. If I correct it well, it's brought as a transistor tester, but it can do more as this. So hope you like the video. So here we see the inner parts of the DY294, and we have here one PCB, and under the display there is a blob. So the microprocessor or whatever is make this stick is not visible, and for the rest are no parts inside. This is the front panel, back panel, and this board sits on top of this board. And there's one thing: if you have one and you want to take it apart to look, be very careful. Note the location of the range switch, which switches are on which side, and how it is formed, and be very careful because the contacts are only pressed on it, and the littlest movement is enough to let you lose the contacts. I made some pictures, so if it happens to you, look on my website and you will see pictures of how the orientation should be. There's not very much to see otherwise than that it is what it is. A microprocessor and a bunch of parts. This is the high voltage circuit. I'll zoom in on it. And this is also not very clean. It looks like it's been a bit rusty or so, but it isn't. It's just not cleaned, and the soldering is not the greatest quality. Look at this one. It looks like there is a hole or so in the solder joint in this one here. It doesn't really look very good. It's just a really cold solder joint just lying on top of it, and it's only the high voltage part, so who cares? It's not really to see on camera, of course, but this solder joint is just laying on top of the board. You can see between the trays and the solder, and on this side I think they run out of solder, so they just tacked that one side. This is the range switch, one of the two, and sides of I mean not the two switches, and you see they made all the vias. It is plated, but the vias are made in the traces, and it is a way to do it, but it's not the best way. And now is this not something you use a lot every day, so it won't damage that fast. Look here at China's finest. The guy who soldered this is definitely going for top solderer of the year. This is just so crap. This is the power supply, and it is. They are just lying on top of the pad. They're not even tacked. There's only pressure contact between the trays and the wire. If you need to solder something like this, then there is a trick to do, because the connectors are only soldered to one side. But if you start resoldering them on one of the two sides, the solder will melt and they drop out because there is no connection. Just take an old header that you don't mind if it become a bit crusty. I press out the. This is a really old one of the pins. Then you put that on, and then you can solder while the header is keeping the connectors in the right position. Just a little trick. And these are the clips. They're okay-ish. Just soldered to the back plane. This is the high voltage part of it. And Yeah, there is nothing other than some transistors and some diodes in there. And now we have the last PCB, which is this one. And here you have the all power resistors for the leakage tests and that sort of thing, so, and the ranges. Just resistors and capacitors. I have not seen... these are fusible resistors, the round ones, and I first took them for caps, but they are also called MOFs, and they're for the protection of the circuit. And you have three in here, and on the other PCB you got this is also a MOF. No, this is a cap, but this is a MOF. This is one and. No. There is some legend with it. These are just caps. These are the together with these diodes they make the high voltage. Yeah. Forgot always the name for Volkraft or something like that. I will edit it in if I think about it. But it's just a voltage multiplier. And for the rest, there is no protection here, but this is the input board, so I would have expected some protection here. Side, we have only two diodes, and for the rest, nothing, at least nothing suited for high voltages or high currents. And the only protection is on this board, but that's not the input. Then, when it's here, it is. No, not always. Some goes through this. These are the connectors for the other board, and they have a legenda with it, like minus BP, bad min minus 6, the COM plus 6, 200 volts, 20 volts, and on this side too, so that is nice. And but the things that come in here, they are going mostly to the switch. I would have preferred the protection before the switch instead of after it, because otherwise the traces can work as a fuse, and that's not what you want. I will do some touching up and cleaning it a bit, and then we put it back together again, and I will do some measurements and some demonstrations of what it can do. So these are the modifications I made. I placed the thermal fuse here. This is the pulse for the capacitor test, so that if there is a loaded charge cap, I hope I don't get all too much damage. And here I enlarged the holes. Also I did that like here. It doesn't look very nice, but that will not be a problem. I'm going to solder banana jacks in there. So, and this is the result. These are for the capacitor testing and isolation testing, and these are for the transistor test. I use some small adapters. This is for normal banana to the 2 meter bananas, and these also. So I can use these if I want. I've got a lot of adapter cables with crocodile and bananas on here, so I found this more easy than here to trying to place three of those big ones in there, because there was not very much space. I think it would been possible, but the advantage of these small ones is that you can also stack transistors or diodes direct in it and make contact. I don't like the springy things. Let's start with a diode. This is made to test semiconductors, so a diode is the first thing we start with. You connect them between the collector and the emitter, and if I put my multimeter on it, you will see we have 5.2 volts there, and that is, to be precise, the power supply voltage. or batteries are now powered to a 6-volt, real life a 5.3 volt power supply. And just because that is handy, and you need it for the for those two positions, but we will see that later. First, let's test the diode. So I have one 007 here, something like that. 00, I can't read it anymore, but should be a 7. If I use the diode tester for my multimeter, you see we have a volt drop of 5 to something 0.5, just a little bit over half a volt. But that value is depending on the current. The lowest current range this meter has is 10 milliamps IC current, and in this case it's from the collector to the emitter in NPN mode. And so if we connect the diode in here, we will get the value, and that's 0.68. So the first thing you would think is they are not they do not agree with each other, but that is the current dependence. This is 10 milliamps, but if I put 100 milliamp to it, you see the voltage drop is going to 0.8, and if I put 800 milliamps to it, then it's 1 volt, and in the 2 volt range it is 1.3 in the 2 amp range. But be careful with it, it just pumps 2 amps to the diode, and that is 1 amp too much. So be careful with not turning the knob without without looking, then you can have a problem. And then there's of course the other parameter you can measure from a diode, and that is what it does when the it is back polarized. So it has the cathode and anode switched around. And in that case, you see we don't measure anything. It's always the 5.28. So it's blocking. But we also have 200 volt range here and 1000 volt range, and that's VBR. That will say the break voltage. So there is a point where this diode can't no longer block the current, and it starts conducting again, like a Zener diode, but then it's more unpredictable. You can do that with the HV voltage test, and here you see 200 volt is no problem. And if we take the 1000 volts, then it's 1433 volts. Always have the numbers wrong. And this is a 1000 volt diode, but this is also about the, if you look at here, it is the open voltage. This, then we have a transistor, that's of course the most common part, although the modern testers which sort out themselves the connections are a bit handier. Here you first have to check if it's an NPN, if it's PNP, and if it what is the base, what is the emitter, and you can do that with the multimeter if you want. So just try like this. Now we have no reading, we have no reading, so we switch around. Hey, now I got 0.54, that sounds good, so this must be the base, and this will be the emitter, and the middle one is almost always the collector. So we have then a base on the left, a collector in the mid, and an amp thing there. And first thing we want to check then is the contacts are very bad. This HFV of 165, and there is something with HFV measurement. It always starts with a small letter H, and then you got in this case the capital F and E. And the H is that it's one of the H parameters. There are all kinds of parameters from there to test transistors. And we have the FE the capital FV will say it is the DC parameter. There is also a small letter FV, and that is the AC parameter, the small signal parameter. And it is nothing more than the ratio between the current on the base and the resulting current to the collector. So if you look at in this thing, if it will keep it between the pins, yeah, that's 169. So the this we have a 10 microamp current going to in the base, and we have 168 times more current going to the collector, from the emitter to the collector. Now, of course, there's also a bit of base current in the total stream and the emitter current, and so it depends on what it exactly is measuring. And I can show you on a curve tracer what the traces mean, and maybe that is a handy thing to do. So this is the curve tracer. I have the transistor there to connect it to the panel, and then this is the screen. I do it from hand because otherwise I cannot place my tripod here. You see all the traces, and if you look at the most downward trace, that is this one here, that is one division high, and one division is like you see here, is an HFE of 100 per division, and I'm feeding it the 10 microamp base current. And if you look at the first trace, that is one division, so we have an HFE of 100. Now here I changed things. Here I took the second value that the tester takes, and that is 1 milliamp. And you see here 1 milliamp per division. We have an HFE of still 100 per division. So the first step it takes here is also one division, so that is 100. But if you look at the scale we now have for milliamps, it was 1 milliamp per division for the current. It is now 100 milliamps per division for the current. So it's drawing here about 800 milliamps in the top trace. Every trace is one step higher in base current. So the most downward is 1 milliamp base current, then you have 2 milliamps, 3 milliamps, 4, 5, and 6. So 6 milliamps base currents. And the HFE with small letters is the distance between those traces, the steps, so the differential step in amplification. So and now compare that same transistor with the tester IV. This is a 10 microamps, so we have here an HFE of 162, and that is almost twice as the current the curve tracer gave. This is what with 1 microamp, and then we have an HFE of 190, and here we have the higher, the 10 milliamp base current, and then we have an HFE of 100, around 100. The connection you make here is not the best. So much for believing the values it gives. It's more important to use it to see if a transistor still is amplifying. And some transistors die just because they go open and there's no current flowing there, otherwise short their base to one of the other pins. But now and then I have seen transistors that do it in the transistor tester. They just gave like this 172 or so, but if you then turn up the base current, the current coming out of the emitter, so the collector current stays the same. It doesn't increase, so it has just fixed gain no matter what you put on the base. And then it's easy, of it's nice to have three different positions. The only downside is that they should then change in HEV. Not like the first two, it was 100 on the curve trace, but also 100 in the second position, and then it went up, and that is also went down, and that's also what is happening here. Here it stays the same, and in the top position it becomes less. But it is always difficult to compare transistor testers. I have 5 or 6 of those. I collect all the test gear, and they always gave different results. And here you have the HEV, but you don't see what the current is doing on the curve trace. You did see a big difference in current. This thing can do all kind of semiconductors like LEDs and TRIAC or whatever, MOSFETs, but it all comes more or less on the same thing that happens. You have just 3 voltages, one for the base, and then they measure the current or measure the voltage over the collector ammeter and the current through it. So I can push in all kinds of components, but that does not do very much. Better to do all the positions in more detail. This is what we just said was HEV. Now we have the VCE, that is the voltage that is between the collector and the emitter. So if you have a transistor that is not conducting, that voltage is as high as the power supply voltage, if there's nothing above it, because there's no current running to it. And what you then do is running current to it, and the more current you run through the transistor, the more it goes open, and the voltage over it decreases. And if you want to use it as a switch, it is important that when it's completely saturated, that the resistance inside is as low as possible, so the voltage drop is also as low as possible, because that way it dissipates the least amount of current and of power. So when we put it in the 10 milliamps per division of the 10 milliamps IC, so now there's running an IC current of 10 milliamps through it, then the volt drop over it is 30 millivolt. If we increase that current to 100 milliamps, then we have a low resistance, more current, so that's most times a higher internal resistance. The Shockley diode is that, in not Schottky, but Shockley diode, and that is from the base to the emitter, and that has a certain resistance, so not all the current you're running through the base is coming one-on-one on the current emitter. So the voltage, then the volt drop changes, it decreases if the current goes up, or it increases, I mean. And if we take 800 milliamps, then we have 333 millivolts, of 330 millivolts. If I take the 2 amps, you see it's now 1 volt over the diode at 2 amps. I don't do that very long, because there is really running 2 amps through this thing. And that's why you need the external power supply for the 800 milliamps and the 2 amps ranges. Now the last thing this thing can measure is the breakdown voltage. And this is the here what we have is the range. They read it in microamps, maximum 2 milliamps, and here you can measure what the leakage voltage is for something you connect between the red and the black here, and you can see if then a transistor is fully not in conduction, so it's fully open. And I can show that with a transistor, but modern transistors don't leak anymore in that. But you can see if that is 2000 milliamps, then the transistor is dead. But you also can see that in the other positions. This is more easy for other things you want to test, and you want to measure some leakage. But yeah, the problem is that the voltage it uses for that is not very high, so that makes it a bit less useful for big components. But if you're working on Arduinos and that sort of things, all low voltage, then it can be useful. And the voltage is what we see over here is 26 volts. You have to push on the knob. It's 26 volts. So you can test a capacitor if it's leaking. If it is a model that uses that has a working voltage, it is low, not higher as 26 volts, because otherwise you won't see things. Be careful with transistors, with capacitors. There is no discharge circuit in it. If you pull it out here, then the thing is still charged. And the one thing that is very nice from this, I will show you too, and that can be very handy. I have here an 8705, probably not reading, but it's not important. We have here 1, 2 and 3 on the display. You put it with a tap towards you, so you put it in backwards, and then if you press, this is an 87.5. This is an 87.5, and that is when I push this button, is a 5 volt regulator, so it's working. That is very nice. I always use the thing that I built myself for that, and this is more easy, of course, because you not need no power supply. This is one of the handy things. I now have a diode, and I use it in this position. That is the voltage collector emitter saturation, and now it's a 10 milliamp current source. So there is now running 10 milliamps to that LED here, and you see there is a 2 volt drop over it, and that is easy to use. And it also can check Zener diodes, and that is also handy because they're often too big for the multimeter if they are in a higher voltage. And you choose the 200 volt range. That's a bit high, but other ranges often will do too, but according to the manual it should be this one. And then you can put a voltage, and this is an 11.8 Zener diode, and that is about the right value. And the last thing we have here is the isolation leakage tester. It is made here for to use like a sort of mirror, an isolation tester, and to test if capacitors are not leaking. And it can 2000 or 200 volts. It is what is on the display, but the open voltage with no load on it is going towards 1500 volts and 270 volts. So be careful if you have things that already think 1000 volt is a lot to test. You can use it to test things like MOSFETs or so, if they're still open. There are all kind of applications in the manual. The manual that came with it was completely in English, but on the web you can also find a Chinglish version. And that's not a bad one. The voltages there are in here, the how you insert it, all the kind of tests you can do. And I made for myself a small just all the drawings together, so I can easily see what to test. But if I can't remember how it should have been done, but that's only for certain components, because for the most things you can do it just from the top of your head. So this is my new tester. The small detail I like from this thing, I'm completely zoomed out, that is that the lid with it, you can use that to cover it up. And so it's more safe like this. It's not closed completely, but you don't lose it, because you can click it on the back of the thing. And it comes in a pouch like this, and it's also nice to keep it in. I have done a drop test by accident. It dropped off my desk on the floor, and it did not sound good, but it survived, no damage, and it still worked. And so it's a nifty handy device to have. It was not expensive. I can't remember the price. I bought it 2 months ago, so somewhere around 40 euros or so. And it's easy to have a voltage choice that just can make 1500 volts and do leakage testing on components. And for me, the main reason was the possibility to test Zenos. Because the only other way I can do that is with my curve tracer, and then you have to warm it up and wait till it's warm. And this one is handy, and it goes up to 1000 volts, so you can. And it's very small current that is running through it, max 1 milliamp. So you, there's not much chance that you fry your components. The connections they made in here I did not like. The one I removed and made the little buses for it was used so you can plug in the power transistors, and then okay, that would be handy, but here I can do this. And for the other ones I made some cables that I can plug in, and these are the cables I made for the leakage tester. Leakage testing of electrolytes, no. It's only dangerous because they stay more or less charged if you pull them out too fast. And you know, still know nothing. You can use it to reform a cap if you have a 400 volt cap or so, or a 200 volt cap or whatever. Then you can use it to reform it. They limit the current, and it is not then 400 volts like this one is. But that does not matter. The reforming will start, and then if you put the thing it is in on, then there's a big chance the reforming goes on, and the capacitor will survive. If I'm now talking about long not used capacitor. If you want to know more about measuring in about capacitor, just ask me in the comments, and I will make a video about it. I have almost any possible kit of gear to measure on capacitors. I can measure from atto farad to farads. So, and this was a quick review of this thing and a few demonstrations. I measured the voltages and measured the currents. It's not a precision device. It is. There are some tremors inside, so maybe it is to adjust to make it more calibrated. Those users. If you use the other half of the scale, then the voltages go around too. So if you take the dark blue side, then this becomes the negative, and this becomes the positive. So that is something to take in account if you use it like I use for other kind of things. And I like it. I just used it yesterday and this morning to test some things, and it is I like it. It is better as it was. Here we had two of those things too, and I made clamps on this thing with some spades that you can push in there, but they always come loose, and then it does not work at all. So, hope you like it. If you like it, I don't mind if you give me a thumbs up or if you subscribe. And I will see you the next time. Bye bye.